And fundamentally, this whole improv and optimism thing is grounded in a response to the question of career building and what type of career do you want. So I've asked you all to reflect on that today as well, from wherever it is that you're sitting. It's really, I think, very hard to carve out time to reflect on those types of questions when you have a patron standing in front of you or a deadline that's tomorrow. So we can all sort of luxuriate in the fact that we have a little bit of time today to spend reflecting on those questions. When I prepared for this talk, I had a conversation with a grad student that's working with me in Washington, and she was like, if I were in the room, I'd want to hear some personal stories. So I turned in some of those to you as well, so if you can indulge me if I use some of those to get some context. Before we dive in, I'll also note that I've had a lot of conversations with colleagues across the country in the past year and a half, and I suspect that this conversation, there's some underlying themes that might resonate with people in this room. the next thing that I would think about when thinking about career building and the role of the career in one's life is what resources you need. And I would not have led with that 10 years ago, because I think that the world is in a slightly different place. When I graduated, we were on the cusp of the Library 2.0 sort of phase, and it seemed like the tone in the field was one of optimism and public thinking, and a lot of evening and weekend hours were being poured into blogs and RSS readers and those types of technology. I think what, at least what I can say based on the national conversations I've been part of, we're witnessing a pendulum swing in that direction. So there's a healthy skepticism about social media, there's nuanced discussions of public and private thinking, whereas you just publicly thought a lot in blogs back 2 years ago. And because of that specific transition, I thought it made sense to talk about resources earlier rather than later. We've heard that saying, job, location, salary, to some extent I found that to be true, but not it's a little, I think, of a gross simplification. I do think that it's a position of privilege to talk about resources at all within the field, because there are such different libraries. I have a very good friend and colleague that works at an institution with almost unlimited travel funding, really great salaries, and more technology than they know what to do. My library does not have many resources. There's a wide spectrum within the field. I do think, and I knew that we have students, so I wanted to mention this in particular, the role of negotiation when getting to the first job is really valuable. And this very good friend of mine, who's very smart, and I would think already knew everything. She's very capable and presents very confidently. But when she got her most recent job offer, she went HR called her. She said, you know I'm supposed to negotiate, but I don't know what I should be asking for. Because every library has different, right? There's stuff you can negotiate with me that you can and others. So that HR department walked her through it, and she ended up with a great deal and way better than she would have been. So I would say feel comfortable being vulnerable in that process. Talk to mentors. You might be able to talk to the HR. In her case, it was sort of a separate office within the library. There might be ways that you could get access to more resources. When I applied for my job, I had just been through a leadership training program, and they pointed out that when you apply for director or dean jobs, you can negotiate beyond just salary. So I spent time negotiating about resources for the staff as well as myself. So I think it's also worth thinking of the total package of what resources do you need for your personal life, what resources do you need for any other people who are relying on you, what resources might you need for the institution to be successful as well. So with that covered, also I think another thing need in the workplace that often doesn't get talked about is community or a place that feels like a healthy place to work. I think was for a while talked about as fit, but I think the word fit has taken on slightly different meanings. And I'm not actually advocating to find your best friends at work either, although it is really powerful to find people that you can connect with. Finding people that who will build you up, support your work, and are focused on meeting the needs of the community and that are open to new ideas. If you can find a community like that, get a lot done, and it can be really fun to go to work. I have been completely blown away by how each place that I've worked with has a completely different culture, and can even each of the three places I've worked in can use the word librarian to mean different things. So, and those are hard questions to ask in an interview. You can't say, so tell me what a librarian is, right? Like, it's assumed. But there are slight differences, and taking some time to poke at that is really valuable. I have also been reading, one of the sort of focuses I've had recently in the field is thinking a lot about equity, diversity, and inclusion, not just at work, but within ACRL. And I've read a lot of articles, too, about how to help the field become a more equitable and inclusive place. And there's been a thread in a number of sort of informal, more like news and journalism type pieces about workplace culture that seems really welcoming, that actually might be exclusive. So, for example, if the group all goes out to a bar after work, people who have family obligations and can't go are automatically excluded from that. Or if the group all goes off to a sporting event and there's someone who's not into that, right, it starts to create sort of walls. Talking about television shows before a meeting can be super fun, but it also can drop cultural signifiers that might make some people feel excluded. So I mentioned this, not because I'm expecting everyone in this room to be changing jobs, but in participating, we all participate in the continual development of workplace culture at our own institutions. And if we're thinking about how to create a welcoming community, a place that people want to be and is a healthy place for everyone, have expertise and what our patrons need. I barely interact with them because I'm busy talking to the administrators. So the team around the table brings that type of expertise. They know our students, they know our faculty, they know what's happening within their specific domains of the field. So we are really specifically articulating what it is we're bringing to those meetings to make sure that we all together find the best answer, rather than me assuming I know when I really don't know what our answers mean, and rather than orienting towards trust in this way means investing a lot of time to build it. It's obviously not something that happens overnight. It's a lot harder and takes a lot more work in the short term at the beginning, but over time, I think it does ease things and it allows everyone to be leaders and be successful and sort of represent the library with the community, which really, I think, my dream state is that every librarian is a strong advocate for their library, for their community, and I think this trust sort of facilitates and enables that. Another key concept in this sort of trust and optimism is having a team orientation. So I think, I mean, that does require being at a conference, but I think it's really symbolic. Just being present in the room and show that you're interested, or being present in an email and show that you're interested. There are opportunities out there. So the cliche of just show up and be there, I think for me, it's kind of like in the future. I think also, it's worth noting, and this is really a theme from yesterday as well, that experiences have value. I'm always surprised at what stories from my past are relevant in very strange other contexts that don't seem to map at all. We talked about this with the design and inspiration phase, but exposure to new places, ideas, people, experiences might not have clear benefits at that moment, but might really be evidently critical to you later on. I was thinking about that during the Ireland presentation. There is one of those things that seems very exploratory, and there's going to be ways to use that in another context. One of the best designs I had in grad school, actually, was to sit in on a bunch of different library instruction sessions, and that was really beneficial to me because I started as an instruction librarian, but it also showed me there was not a right way. There were, as many people as I observed, different ways of teaching, and it opened the door to a spectrum. And I didn't teach like any of them, but it helped me understand where I could sort of play with it and what I could test out and sort of gave some framework for it. When I was at Wake Forest, we would take field trips all the time, and I cannot recommend this highly enough. We were so lucky to be in North Carolina. This is not possible in Washington. But there's so many amazing libraries so close to each other that we could regularly go and see places. And good libraries are customized for their community, so we never could just pick up something that we saw at another library, but we could take variables and apply them in different ways. And that's something like in my state, there's just not as many libraries, and it's very difficult to travel. So I think that is a luxury of people. That is very much about getting these experiences that in the moment aren't necessarily clearly tied to an outcome, but will lead to something beneficial later on. So with that, and sort of in conclusion, I'd say at this point, about a third of the way through my career, I found that I've been building a career of advocacy that necessitated moving to administration. And I realized that I wanted to do that, but still have the quality of life at home. And there's a way, like, I was able to find a way to do that. So I think there are ways that no matter what the life is that you want, you can find a way to do it. And when I get to a core of it, I think that an optimism and a belief in my problems and an openness to possibility have been threads throughout my career. And without this mindset, I don't think my career would be what it is. And without the jobs I've had, I'm not sure I could have fully articulated these mindsets either. So with that, I'd ask you all to think about your career, whether you're in library school or closer to retirement. What career is it that you want to build? What values mean to you will get you where you want to be and to live the life you want to live? So with that, are there any questions or comments or points of discussion you should have? That was a lot of talking, so it might be hard. Yes.
Well, I'm just curious, because you said you're not an improviser, and what led you to the improv framework?
Yeah, so I do a lot of exploratory reading about other fields because I do think that it's very easy to get sucked into the library literature and then have this library mindset. So I spend a lot of time in a lot of different literature trying to find threads of things that might be relevant and might give us just a slightly different perspective on the challenges that we're facing because maybe we'll learn something. And this was one of the, there's a number that I read, a number of things that come across. I'm like, yeah, this is
next article.
I want to just push back a little bit, because I mean, I'm a big advocate of all about remembering what Booker T. Washington said about putting down your bucket where you are. And I think sometimes I think there is value. I'm not saying that people shouldn't have the option of moving from a bad situation, but I think there are ways that we can make changes in our institutions and in our communities. I'm just trying to see how that fits into this framework. So, I mean, not to critique what you're saying, but it seems to me a tad egocentric, like it's focused on the individual and his or her aspirations, like what life do you want? And I don't know, like what does the community fit into that?
Yeah, well, the reason I framed it that way is that I think from conversations with numerous people across the field, people think about the community differently for their own choice. So it really is fundamentally in a leadership talk. The first question is, what are you trying to do? In my case, it is about the profession and the field. So it
one is in charge. And so it is a very like hive mind. That's also one of the things. It's like if you're a good team, then everyone will get to the same word without preparing for it. So it's like there's a lot of overlap, and I think it's really interesting. But I do think that if you like take the root of the idea, it's very much like the self doesn't exist.
Thank you. That is so much clearer.
Not a question, but a comment. You just mentioned it today, you mentioned it yesterday, but the idea of like what does a word mean, linguistics of what we're saying. And I really appreciated that being something that I've heard this weekend, because I find that a lot of the times I'll be in a room and we all have different ideas. And so it's like, but the community needs blank. And but like in my head, community is like, I don't know, when I work in the YA section, it's like I just think about like the toddlers to 14-year-olds that are coming in, and I don't think about like the schools and like the other things, whereas like other people sometimes don't think about, but like we all have different ideas.